No.
Okay, just until we figure it out, I will just have to talk a little bit louder.
Yes.
Okay? Boy, when a preacher gets to talk louder, that's just awesome. Bear with me then, friends. We apologize. Technical difficulties. But again, welcome on this July 3rd weekend. So good to have you with us here today. And let us begin with prayer. Lord of all the worlds, guide this nation by your Spirit to go forward in justice and freedom. Give to all people the blessings of well-being and harmony. But above all things, give us faith in you, that we may bring glory to your name and blessings to all peoples. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. As I invite you to stand for the singing of the first
one,
hymn,
two,
if
three,
all of a sudden four. My voice gets very loud, Brenda, will you please just wave at me so I can hold it down? Okay?
One,
we sing.
Two, three, four.
Show deference to no one, for
For you do not regard people with partiality, but teach the way of God in accordance with truth. Is it lawful to pay taxes to the emperor or not? Should we pay them or should we not? But knowing their hypocrisy, he said to them, why are you putting me to the test? Bring me a denarii and let me see it. And they brought one. Then he said to them, whose head is this and whose title? They answered, the emperor's. Jesus said to them, give to the emperor the things that are the emperor's, and to God the things that are God's. And they were utterly amazed at him. The Gospel of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please be seated.
Deacon Diane is coming forward. Can you hear me any better now?
No.
Okay.
Okay, is mine working? Does it appear to be working? No. Okay. I do invite our young people forward. If you would like to come. Would you like to come? Come? Okay. Yeah, join me. Okay. I will also just talk loud. I want to share something with you today from the book of Romans. Have you heard of the book of Romans in the Bible? No, probably not. It's not really one we talk about until you're kind of older in the catechism and stuff like that. So it is kind of deep into the Bible, right, in the New Testament, okay? And in our other services, we're reading part of this reading from Romans today, but we didn't read it here today, so I'm going to read you a couple of verses, okay? So this comes from Romans chapter 13, and it's verses 8, 9, and 10. And in my Bible, it has a title. It says, love one another. And these verses connect what Jesus is saying to the Ten Commandments that were in the Old Testament. That's kind of neat, isn't it? Okay? So, owe no one anything except to love one another. For the one who loves one another has fulfilled the law. So then Jesus lists some of the commandments, and it says, all commandments are summed up in this word, love your neighbor as yourself. Love does no wrong to a neighbor. Therefore, love is the fulfilling of the law. You probably heard love your neighbor before, right? Yeah, so it comes from here. This is one of the places in the Bible that it talks about that. So, we are called to love our neighbor because God loves us. And it's like a circle thing, right? So God puts in the love, and through us, then we put out the love to others. It's kind of what that's about. So, what do you think you can do that shows God's love to others?
What do you think? Any ideas? It might be kind of hard to think of some, right? So, one of the things that Jesus says is that we are to treat others like we want to be treated, right? So we want people to be kind to us, right? And help us when we need help. So that's what we can do for others, right? We can be gentle with each other. We can show our love and kindness by smiling when we walk by, or holding a door, or just waving to your neighbor across the street, right? That kind of thing. So one of the other things I thought we could do this week, because it's been so hot outside and it's going to continue to be hot outside, and I know in the communities around here there are boxes and they're called free pantries. Like people can drop stuff off in them and other people can pick them up as they might need. But I thought maybe we should put water and juice boxes and stuff like that in the free pantries this week, because people working outside or walking by could probably use something to drink, right? So that could be one way we could help. And next week, starting on July 11th, we're having our vacation Bible school, and we're going to take up a special collection for one of our missions that we sponsor here at the church. So that's one way we can be a good neighbor. And then in September, the whole of the church, the ELCA, we're part of the ELCA, that's so churches across the country, Lutheran congregations, gather together in all of their neighborhoods for something called God's Work Our Hands Day. And so we're going to be part of that too. And we have a group going to Ronald McDonald House to make dinner for the people staying there. We have another group that are going to make flower pots, like fall flower pots or plants for the people at Ronald McDonald House to brighten their rooms a little bit. There's all kinds of ways that we can be good neighbors and show God's love, right? But it's not easy, like I said, and we need help. So let us pray, okay? And you can repeat after me. Dear God, help us love our neighbors with all our hearts as you love us, and guide us to show your love every day and all day. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you for coming.
And I think my mic is working now, right? Okay, thank you, Carrie and Eric Lehman. Reverend, you're on.
Is that a good thing that your mic is working?
Well, now, I don't know. That's, you said that, I didn't.
Good morning, everyone. Welcome to worship on this beautiful Sunday morning. All of you here, gathered here, and everyone online, the millions around the world listening in and worshiping with us today. In the name of our Lord Jesus. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus, the risen Christ. Amen. Most blessed July 4th weekend to everybody. You have, I'm sure, heard the phrase, freedom isn't free. Freedom isn't free. That's true, isn't it? That's the truth. Freedom isn't free. We celebrate the freedoms that we have in this country. We celebrate the lives of those thousands and thousands of men and women who have given their lives over the past century, two centuries and a half, that we could be here today. And we also give thanks to you folks, the thousands and thousands more of you who sacrificed time with your spouses, with your kids, your families, as you were stationed somewhere around the world, most likely the last place you would want to be. Sacrifice, sacrifice. Freedom isn't free, is it? Somebody has to pay the tab. And it's the same way with our freedom from sin and death. We couldn't hire somebody to do it. There are no volunteers that we could pull together to do it, no mercenaries. We couldn't do it ourselves, can't do it ourselves. No, God, only God himself in Christ Jesus was the only one who could do that, the cross, to free us from sin and death. Took everything God had and has. Freedom isn't free, no matter how you cut it. A physical freedom, a spiritual freedom, either way, freedom isn't free. Our gospel lesson for this morning is really perfect for this time in history. On this celebration of Freedom Weekend, which isn't free, I'm reminded every year, and really more than just every year, but especially around July 4th, Jesus' words from Luke chapter 12, verse 48. He says this, "To whom much has been given, much, much will be required." And to say without question, in this country, we have been given much. We have been blessed abundantly. It is most likely that of all the countries that have ever existed in the world, we have been blessed the most. What does God require of us? But it's not just about country. It's about our congregation, blessed abundantly. It's about ourselves personally, blessed abundantly. What does God require of us? So our gospel lesson from Mark chapter 12. You got a dinosaur? You know what? I think, is that a T-Rex? Tyrannosaurus Rex. That's my favorite dinosaur. That and the Triceratops. We were with our grandkids the last couple weeks, and I was overwhelmed by dinosaurs, plastic dinosaurs and everything else. So I know my dinosaurs now, so that's good. But I'm convicted by our gospel lesson today. And by convicted, I mean I'm challenged by. My conscience is triggered. My radar goes up. I'm convicted by the Lord. I am challenged by the Lord through it. Why is that? Well, I'm going to get to that in a moment. But first, let's take a look at this moment in Jesus' ministry. A bit of context. This conversation takes place during Holy Week. During Holy Week. So what has already happened before this conversation today is Jesus has ridden into Jerusalem on a donkey, Palm Sunday. He has cleansed the temple on Monday, which didn't win him any popularity contests. Right? So he cleansed the temple. He talked about the importance and the necessity of forgiveness and grace. He talked about his authority because the Pharisees have already come up to him this week and said, "Who died and made you God?" He's talked about the parable of the vineyard owner. Remember that parable where the vineyard owner goes away, he leaves his vineyard in charge of his supervisors, if you will, and the workers end up beating the supervisors until he finally sends his own son to supervise the operation, and they kill him. So it's a foreshadowing of what would happen on Good Friday. And now this, a question about taxes, which seemed to be relatively benign, right? A question about taxes. A couple of important things to note here. The Pharisees and the Herodians were sent together to try to trap Jesus. Now, these were both Jewish groups, right? The Pharisees, we know them. We see them just about every week. They were strict keepers of the law of Israel. And they had a philosophy that said, since we are the keepers of the law, that means that we're the only ones who can keep the law, which means the rest of you can't, which means we're the only one God likes. We're the only ones God likes. And that's why Jesus is always butting heads with them. So you got the Pharisees on one hand, and then you have these Herodians who were Jews who were sympathizers with Rome. Jewish Roman sympathizers, Herodians, King Herod the Great. Herod Agrippa. They supported the Herods and the Romans, even though they are by birth Jews. They are Roman sympathizers, which is kind of interesting. The Pharisees and Herodians very rarely exchanged Christmas cards. They very rarely had potlucks together. They never worshiped together. They didn't like each other much. They wouldn't walk across the street for the other. Pharisees and Herodians. This would be like saying, how would you respond if you saw in tomorrow's headlines for the 4th of July celebration, the Democrats and Republicans in Washington, D.C. are getting together for a potluck on the White House lawn? I'd probably faint, say it's fake news. There's no way this happened. That's kind of the way the Pharisees and the Herodians were. Politically. So this means that for the Jews, things are getting serious as it relates to Jesus. Whatever political and religious differences, and they were profound, the Pharisees and the Herodians had, were nothing compared to the problem of Jesus. The problem of Jesus, who continues to cause problems 2,000 years later, but we'll get to that here in a few minutes. The second important thing to know is this. Is that the taxes spoken of here by the Pharisees and the Herodians to trap Jesus was a special tax levied only on the Jewish population. Roman citizens didn't have to pay this tax. This was only on the Jewish population. It was called a census tax, and it was a tax meant to pay homage to Caesar, who thought he was God. So in other words, whenever it came time for the Jews to pay this tax, it was meant to remind the Jews as to who was the boss, namely Caesar. So here's the conundrum. We turn to verses 14 and 15 in our gospel lesson. It says this, "And so they came to him," meaning the Pharisees and the Herodians, "and said to him, 'Teacher, we know that you are true and do not care about anyone's opinion, for you're not swayed by appearances, but only teach the way of God.'" How do you respond to that? Pardon the graphic nature of this. Right? It's getting deep in here. That's what that meant. They were flattering him, a false flattery, right? Oh, teacher, we know that you're the man. We know that what you say, God, they don't believe that for a minute. They're trying to butter him up, and they think he doesn't get it. Right? So they say to Jesus, by the way, is it lawful to pay taxes to Caesar or not? Should we pay them or should we not pay them? What are you going to say about this, Jesus? In other words, Pharisees, Herodians, you can imagine they're winking at each other, elbowing each other. We've got him this time. From their perspective, if Jesus said, pay the tax, from the Pharisees' perspective, he was telling Jews it was okay to pay homage to Caesar. That meant trouble. From the Herodian perspective, if he said, don't pay the tax at all, it was disobeying Caesar. So they were in trouble with Herod and the Romans. Right? Either way, they're thinking Jesus is toast. No matter what direction Jesus goes with this answer, he is finished. And so how does Jesus answer the question? Verses 16 and 17. But knowing their hypocrisy, he said to them, why put me to the test? Bring me a denarii and let me look at it. Here's the thing. It was lawfully illegal, religiously illegal. And that's what lawful means here. It's a religious law. It's not a civic law. Religious law. It was religiously unlawful for a Pharisee or any Jew at all, Herodian too, as a Jew, to carry any Roman coinage that had the image of Caesar. So when it says here, knowing their hypocrisy, he says, show me a denarii. And you see the Pharisees digging in their pocket for a denarii. They're not supposed to have one. It's illegal to have one. But they provide one, knowing their hypocrisy. Right? He said to them, why put me to the test? Bring me a denarii and look. Let me look at it. And they brought one to him. And he said to them, whose likeness and inscription is this? They said to him, Caesar's. And Jesus then said to them, render to Caesar the things that are Caesar's, and to God the things that are God's. And they marveled at him. They marveled at him. By the way, the word likeness, the word image, comes from the Greek word icon. Yes, that's where we get the English word icon. An icon, a likeness, a resemblance, a representation of. That's what that means here. So Jesus' answer is simple and profound. As simple as profound as you can get. Simply profound. Image is everything, Jesus is saying here. Image is everything. Remember back in the 1990s, I think in 1990, Andre Agassi, famous tennis player, who came out and he was the spokesman for Canon cameras, and the theme was image is everything. Image is everything, Jesus says. We are made in the image of God. That means everything. What belongs to whom? Whom belongs to whom? Give to Caesar what belongs to Caesar. What belongs to Caesar? Stuff, maybe. Give to God what belongs to God. What belongs to God? And Jesus' words are just as important and true today as they were then. We still have Caesar, right? We still have Caesar, that's the world, and we still have God. And image is still everything. Image is still everything. I've told this story a million times, mostly around stewardship. And you probably remember the story of a little boy who wandered in a church on Sunday morning during worship, sat in the back row, got in there just in time for the offering. He noticed that these gold plates were being passed back and forth and people were putting money in, and the little boy was a little bit hesitant and embarrassed because he had no money with him. What was he going to do? So when the plate came to him, he took the plate, set it in the middle of the aisle, and he stood in the plate. He stood in the plate. And whether or not he knew what he had just done or understood what he had just done, in giving himself to God, which was what he was doing, right? He was giving to God what already belonged to God, in essence, himself. Image is everything. And whether or not we understand the importance of that sets our mindset, our purpose, our sense of hope and belonging and meaning, our worldview and our perspective. How does understanding that you and all of humanity is of the image of God, that truth, how does that affect our view of life? How do we live our lives as folks created in the image of God? In the image of God. How do we relate to God, to the Lord? How do we relate to one another? How do we relate even to ourselves? And this circles back to my initial statement that I am challenged by this text. I'm convicted by this text. A young boy who was frustrated with all the rules that he had to follow asked his father, "Dad, how soon will I be old enough to do anything I want to do? How soon will I be old enough to do anything I want to do?" His father answered, "Son, I don't know. Nobody has lived that long yet." Nobody's lived that long yet. Freedom. What does freedom mean in light of image is everything? Freedom isn't free. A young boy carries a popular understanding of freedom to do anything I want. It's my right. I deserve it. I can do anything I want. Imagine what this world would be like if everybody, that's how we define freedom. Anything we want to do, whenever we want to do it, to whomever we want to do it to. What would the world be like? It would be a horrible hell on earth. It would be a train wreck. It would be beyond comprehension, the horror of something like that. The fact that we are God's imagers, we are images of the Father, says some things about freedom, that it's not about doing what we want when we want to do it. It's not. You know, on this 4th of July weekend here in 2022, we have many issues dividing us in these United States. Many issues. And not just in the country, but in the world. We have religious divisions. We have political divisions. We have geopolitical divisions. We have divisions over rights and freedoms. And I was thinking this week, my wife, Sharon, said, "Are you sure you want to go there?" And I said, "Well, probably, yeah. I think that's what the Lord wants me to do, so we're going there. So hang on, just listen." I was thinking this week, how would Jesus respond to the pro-life versus pro-choice conversation? If he was standing right here in front of us, and we asked him, "What do you think about this, Lord?" What do you think he would say? I'm not saying what I would think. Oops, sorry. What I would think or what you would think. This is not about politics. This is Democrat. This is Republican. This is life. And it's death. Based upon what we know about the Lord, based upon the truth that image is everything, that is what bears the image of the world versus what bears the image of God. Render to Caesar what belongs to Caesar. Render to God what belongs to God. What would Jesus say, you think? What would Jesus say? Well, Jesus had a habit of jumping back into the Old Testament to form the foundation of what he was coming to fulfill and sometimes even to add to. But just a couple of passages from the Old Testament as a reminder for us. There are lots of them. I'm just going to share with you four. And I'm not going to make any comments about them because they're pretty straightforward. Isaiah chapter 44, verse 2. Thus says the Lord who made you, who formed you from the womb, and will help you. Thus says the Lord who made you. That's image, right? That's back to image is everything. Who formed you from the womb and will help you. How about Isaiah 49, verses 1 and 5. Listen to me, O coastlands, and give attention, you peoples, from afar. The Lord called me from the womb, from the body of my mother, he named my name. And now the Lord says, he who formed me from the womb to be his servant, to bring Jacob back to him, that Israel might be gathered to him. For I am honored in the eyes of the Lord, and my God has become my strength. And now the Lord says, he who formed me from the womb to be his servant. How about Jeremiah chapter 1? Jeremiah chapter 1, verses 4 and 5. Now the word of the Lord came to me, saying, before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. And before you were born, I consecrated you. I appointed you a prophet to the nations. And finally, Psalm 139, verses 13 through 16. David writes, for you formed my inward parts. You knitted me together in my mother's womb. I praise you, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Wonderful are your works. My soul knows it very well. My frame was not hidden from you when I was being made in secret, intricately woven in the depths of the earth. Your eyes saw my unformed substance. In your book were written, every one of them, the days that were formed for me, when as yet there was none of them. Now, for those who live by the image of the world, who live by the image of the world, those texts and what Jesus says in today's gospel lesson mean very little, if anything at all, because it's not foundational for them. It means very little at all. Maybe a laugh, a sneer, a mocking, maybe a few expletives. And a few exceptions, certainly a mother's life in jeopardy. That's a different question altogether. And then you pray and you make the best decision you can. That's not what I'm talking about. We're talking about here the taking of life as birth control, as convenience, as my life would be a whole lot easier if this would happen. And by the way, if any, you need to hear this. This is so important. If anybody who's listening to this has gone through that, know that God's grace is bigger than that moment. That you are held in God's loving arms in forgiveness and grace as you come to him. Even something like that doesn't have the last word in your life. God does. And his arms are open in grace. Through the love of Christ Jesus. You see, it doesn't change the truth. That image is everything. And the only image that lasts, that matters, that counts, is the image of God in your soul and the sign of the cross on your heart. Image is everything, and freedom isn't free. So they brought it, and he said to them, whose image and inscription is this? They said to him, Caesar's. And Jesus answered and said to them, render to Caesar the things that are Caesar's, and to God the things that are God's. And they marveled at him. Amen.
Please stand and join us in singing, We Are an Offering. Let us pray. Gracious God, because we are not strong enough to pray as we should, you provide Jesus Christ and the Holy Spirit to intercede when we go astray. In this confidence, we pause as a people to lift up our prayers. Prayers of thanksgiving, intercession, lamentation, and petition. And we ask you to accept the prayers we offer that serve your will and fulfill the vision that you have for our nation and world. God of mercy, hear our prayer. As we give thanks for the many freedoms we enjoy, we pray for peoples and countries struggling and suffering under oppressive regimes, abusive systems of power, and coercive means of control. And especially we lift up the country of Ukraine. We pray for our nation's leaders who hopefully seek creative ways to address so many complex problems here at home. We pray for the safety and well-being of our military personnel, especially those serving in harm's way, and all law enforcement officials. We pray for all those who are traveling this weekend, that they might be responsible and safe. We pray for those in our nation and all over the world waiting to be freed from hunger, poverty, and the ravages of injustice. God of mercy, hear our prayer. Compassionate God, as we continue to move through this pandemic, we pray for good health and healing. Lift up the depressed, console those who grieve, comfort the anxious, and fill all people with your Holy Spirit, that we might bear each other's burdens and so fulfill the law of Christ. God of mercy, hear our prayer. United as a family of faith and blessed abundantly as the body of Christ, we lift these prayers up to you, O God, you who are our Creator, our Redeemer, and our Sustainer. Amen. Please be seated. I'm going to share with you just a couple of announcements. First of all, we ask your prayers for Stephen Roth and family. His mother, Audrey, passed to her eternal home this past Thursday. The funeral arrangements are still pending. We invite you to join us on Thursday evening, July 14. That'll be the end of the Vacation Bible School experience for the kids, and we want you to join in the party. It's supposed to be running from 7 to 8 p.m. that evening. We ask you to bring a lawn chair and make yourself comfortable right out on the front lawn, and there will be wonderful music, dancing, and stories for all. And we invite you to join us that same evening for a complimentary snow cone or two provided by Icy Cool Treats Food Truck. And that will be a gift to all of us from our Vacation Bible School team. And just one final note, many of you are familiar with Emmett Cahill, the Irish tenor, who has done a couple of concerts with us here in recent years. We have received word that he has a special concert via the internet, a live concert from Ireland tonight at 7 o'clock, celebrating our American independence. Not only with patriotic songs for America, but then some of his music from his beloved homeland as well. Tickets are available for that concert. I have the internet address that you would need to order those, but if you are interested, please check with me following the service. And we continue with the offertory. Please stand for confession and Holy Communion. We come before God and each other in a time of confession. O God, you have blessed us richly. Forgive us for those times we failed to give back to you through our worship, tithes, prayers, and presence. Forgive us for those times we failed to use our blessings to help others. Forgive us when we let others stop us from being a blessing. Forgive us for being silent when you have given us a voice. Amen. Our God, who has blessed us so richly, welcomes us to his table with forgiveness, love, and joy. So today, come and eat and drink to be nourished and energized to be God's people in the world. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks. He broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." And again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. It is shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." And we pray as our Lord taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Please be seated. Just a little reminder regarding procedure. As we invite you to come forward for Holy Communion, you'll receive one of these little chalices. At the top is a wafer to be peeled back for access. Tip it upside down, remove the top, and drink the grape juice that is there. You're welcome to stay here at the rail, either kneeling or standing, or you can take it back to the pew with you and commune yourself there. But wherever you do that, know that this is the body and blood of Jesus Christ given for you.
So good, God is so good, God is so good, he's so good to
Please stand for the blessing. The body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen. And now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord's face shine upon you with grace and mercy. May the Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen. Peace, be safe, serve the Lord. Thanks be to God.